joining us for this panel, we have Sav Zilberstein, who is the director at Hyperion. Sav. Alex Kornilov, who is the CEO and founder of Bedigy. And Krister Malm, who's the managing director at Adzium. Thanks for joining us. Again, if you have a question, raise your hand at any point. That will make this more relevant and more fun for everyone. So feel free to raise your hand whenever you have a question. But let's start with talking about tech specialties and disruption. What disruptors do you see having affected the market here in Sweden, and what do you see on the horizon? I think is probably a good place to start. Anyone on the panel?
Okay, so mainly, as we now talk, I've been listening very, very carefully to all the changes which happened just recently, and everyone is talking about changing actually in regulations, and the main problem as far as I see is the content creation, and not only content creation, but the problem is that everyone is aware of the problem, but no one is offering the solution. And in my opinion, since we work with data for a very long time as a company, data is an integral part of the of the sports, and since the sport is an integral part of sports betting, creation of a good content based on data is the answer in this case. And having the solutions which help to create content and tell the story will help operators and affiliates to acquire new customers, and in this kind of regulatory environment. And I would see more and more solutions and services coming in this area, which help to create marketing materials and scale based on event-based data. And that's how I see it.
What about innovation in game type based on sports data? I mean, before data came in, rather 10 years ago, data came in rather slowly, and you only had major instances in the game or major events in the game being reported on. But now you're getting thousands of data points from a game, and there's technology being developed where AI actually watches the game and creates literally millions of data points in the game. How's that going to affect the future of sports betting and game type? I mean, we've seen a few bits of data introduced in running gaming.
The thing is, I think the main challenge right now for, especially in the region of AI, is that AI is kind of a vague word for most people. So I think it's good to just try to simple it out a little bit. So obviously it won't capture the entire frame of AI, but mainly AI goes into play when you have big data first. So yeah, as much as cloud computing evolved, we have more and more big data accumulated and available for use. And the main thing is that you want to form pattern recognition. That's for now, narrow AI, that's just what it does. It can look on huge amounts of data and find patterns and then do something for you. And that do something, I think this is the most challenging for most companies, because they say, I want AI as well. What should I do with it now? And that's the big issue. So it's about pattern recognition. I think one thing we saw already more in casino in relating to compliance was that the patterns can be recognized, for example, for a bettor that goes out of control. And then obviously, less happy for the affiliate, but better for society that it can identify and stop in time inflamed behavior of betting or going out of control. Why? Because you can see a pattern or a segment of certain behaviors. And then if something fluctuates, maybe in a huge picture of thousands of players playing, it will be really hard to see that, but the machine can do that. So, but where could it come into play also on the operator side, not only in compliance and in recognition of bettors' behavior? That can be, for example, as long as regulations allow it, for content discovery. So Spotify was born here, right, in Sweden. And one of the best things that the AI can do is to profile a certain player or listener and say what he's going to like to listen to next. And this can be done as well in terms of operators, because right now I think, like the former panel said, people sit here and say, why should I promote EvoPlay or any other game provider? if their margins are so or so, and there's a constant like kind of battle between all the forces that dominate an operator. Instead, what about the fact that there might be a profile of a player that just sits, and the AI can know which kind of games or activities he might be attracted to more by forming like a content discovery instead of that manual thing. So I think just connecting also to the last panel, like, because still the forces are fighting manually, it's better to step aside and let the machines do that. That's kind of what AI can be used for, like in the next years. And I think we will see that at some point.
Well, I can actually add and just say we have it. It's really interesting what you're saying, because in particular this type of player profiling, we're doing exactly that for the operators. And as an affiliate, I think taking that step and actually becoming slightly more technically, well, not slightly, but a lot more technically advanced, and understanding what type of players you have and what type of players you bring to the operators, that empowers you. So when discussing with operators, of course, if we know that we have a particular type of customer that's really attractive to them, it gives us the power to negotiate better deals. So I think it all boils down to really what you have to offer, like in all type of business. So in terms of technology, and as you said, the Spotify sort of comparison, I think having that and understanding what they've done and how they've been successful is really down to how they've utilized the data of their users. And that, I think, is key for all affiliates as we move forward.
So, Chris, you're suggesting that your software is going to profile the player, determine what content to serve that player, what games, what offers, and where to send them to best maximize that player value?
Correct.
That's pretty cool. Is this something you're offering to other affiliates? Are you keeping this in-house, or is this going to be a service that's going to be available to everyone else?
Currently, it's in-house, but we are investigating the possibility to license it.
Yeah, sounds pretty cool. I'll take two. So the tech trends, I think what we're saying is tech trends are going toward bigger data, but the need for AI to manage bigger data. It's clear in sports. How does that work in other games? The profiling, I suppose, works for the player.
You mean in other games? Which games do you mean? Like casino?
Casino games, let's say.
Basically, predictive analytics is the answer. I mean, profiling the player and knowing the patterns, how they influence. And it's not only about profiling the player and about acquisition, it's also about retention. Especially it's important in our industry. And AI can give you answers like when the player is stopped, will stop to play, when the churn happened, what is the actual, like, it's not only about acquisition, but also about like performance patterns. And so we know when the player will churn, so we can do the reactivation marketing to him, and we can do all kinds of things. And this is highly applicable to any industry where you have a collection of data. Therefore, if we talk about online, it's basically everything. If we talk about offline, it's where it can be measured. I don't know how well is developed the offline industry in this region, but it seems to me that it's still underdeveloped. There are no like devices which help you to measure incoming, outcoming traffic from the betting shops and all kind of such things. And this is a huge place to improve. It's like shop analytics and all kind of such things will be a trend soon, because it's quantifiable. It means that you can apply the AI and big data, and then you can make the reasonable assumptions, and then you can do the actions actually to gain the extra margins and extra time of a player there. Yeah.
I agree, and I think that most affiliates have been lacking in understanding the retention aspects. The majority of affiliates have been trying to push acquisition very much over the years. Of course, it's slightly changing now, but I think understanding what's necessary to prevent churn is absolutely critical. And once again, using the data models that can be applied on big data is definitely of use there.
I mean, I would say that, again, there is a black hole kind of between the operators right now and the affiliates because of this cloak and dagger game. And there has to be some kind of channel of flowing data between the two in order to allow finally the machine to step in and say what's best, again, according to regulations. Because at some point, I think what's going to happen is it's going to get so good that regulations will come to restrict AI from reaching its edge, because in the end of the day, you have many operators have affiliate traffic, but it's like a huge noise. And then unfortunately some operators just shave the affiliates to some extent, and then the affiliates say, you know, that's what starts this war. Everybody thinks that someone is hiding something, but actually a machine could segment all incoming traffic sources and actually expose which are the best affiliates, which are less, and even to segment content display to certain flows, inflows from different affiliates, because many people will think, oh, the Swedish market, it's all the same. You just bring me Swedish players. But Swedish players is such a broad definition. I mean, like we cannot be profiled into a region or a race, we can also not be profiled to a segment as wide as a Swedish player. So I believe actually with exposure to like you say, to in more intelligent way of analytics, there can be much smarter segmentation and content display also. But this is not going to happen before there will be some more transparency also. I mean, how can an affiliate improve itself if he will never know really, except for some vague conversions and payouts, what he's supposed to do, you know? When you have an e-commerce business, for example, it's very easy to see what's the value, which products are being bought, and analyze all kind of stuff. I don't think it's different here. So it will be a matter that at some point one operator will pick up the glove and start sharing a bit more information. It will become less confidential, kind of, to keep everything for yourself, and then yeah, the market will change. But yeah, who's gonna take this step first? That's basically what will start all of this.
That's a very good point. I mean, there's clearly a lot of there's a lot of operators with a lot of technology. There aren't necessarily a lot of affiliate programs with a lot of technology. Do you think that the lack of technology on the affiliate program side, or do you think there's lack of technology on the affiliate program side compared to the technology available to affiliates? And is that going to be what, like you said, limits how far you can go with your technologies?
From our perspective, we developed the technology to understand instead. We saw that there was a lack of data available from the operators, and due to that lack and due to the fact that we couldn't see the relevant data and actually understand our users, we developed it. So I think it's something that a lot of affiliates should consider, unless it becomes available otherwise.
But there's also a lack of optimization, I suppose, on the affiliate program side. Whereas you're going to want to show particular content to a person, you're going to games with certain tolerances for variance to different players, and you're going to want to, as you said before, Seth, you're going to want to narrowly segment these players into what they really want. Are you getting the programs coming back to you and saying, yes, okay, when you send that type of player, I'm going to serve them this type of content, and is that technology up to snuff with what you need to maximize player value?
We do that, so we don't need it. So we sorted that out from our perspective.
And just to add to this, look what is happening now. Like, affiliates develop the technology themselves, where the operator is standing behind and just giving you a service of vagaring, which is very interesting shift in mind what we have now. Operators in general having the same offer. Everyone has the same offer. And the betting itself becomes a utility. So actually, affiliates start to control the first touch with the client, then segmenting it, then giving the right message, and then saying, okay, go and bet. So what we see is the operators, they become a utility. And no one actually cares where to bet from. So what we will see in the future, if operators will stay like this now, being a utility company like electricity or internet, you'll see that all the value goes to affiliates now, and they try to do it, they develop this technology. So the way for operators not to die and have the values to build a brand from one side, and from second, invest into such technologies themselves, giving this technology to affiliate, creating this kind of closing the distance between affiliate and operator actually on a acquisition funnel and a marketing funnel. And that's amazing example what you say. You develop it yourself to be better, and actually you don't care which operator then, you know, where the person makes a bet. It would be best that they just license the service to you, like as a through API, so the player will not know actually where they do the bet. So you are holding all the information and brand engagement and segmentation. This is amazing what's going on, you know. So
I think we also see that. I mean, I met with another company, a German, I don't remember their name, but there is like a kind of a broker phenomena that is starting. And I think a broker basically collects the, it's not an affiliate anymore. It used to be an affiliate, it's kind of the next step. They start collecting payment data and storing it, and then kind of offering the best bet in the market to operators. Operators do get kind of the KYC in the process and open themselves a user, but the loyalty of the user stay with the broker. And the reason that this is happening is exactly because operators were blocking affiliates from reaching to technology and being able to segment and make users smarter, so brokers start to appear. And because brokers show better way of segmentation and better way of content discovery to their users, the users stop using. It's like Opodo with airlines, you know? Opodo is such a great flight search engine that you won't go even if you they tell you, this is Air Malta, you can go and buy the ticket there, but you're so used to the engine, it's so great service, you just buy your ticket from the engine. And this is, the phenomena of brokers is a little bit like evolution, you know? You push a virus and then in the end it evolves, it's the same. Like you keep the affiliates out of the game, someone from technology is going to pick up the glove and say, well, I can do it much better. They never give me what I need, so I'm just gonna make it myself. And because the licenses allows brokers to exist, I think this is a phenomenon that is actually going to rise. We're gonna see that, especially with sports betting and next step, esports. Now that that cloud gaming is starting to appear, don't know how many of you are aware of it, but there's an evolution going on. If you hear of Stadia is just one example of Google's attempt to move gaming to the cloud, which means we don't need, for example, expensive hardware in our home anymore. We don't need a gaming computer to play an amazing looking game. It's all gonna run in the cloud and in seconds. So it means content is going to become abundant and game developers are going to start blasting all over the place. Now, you cannot no longer be, like you say, like a clerk that just comes and picks up the bet slip and moves on. You're gonna have to provide a lot more of experience to your users and understand them in order to stay relevant.
Exactly, and I think just to sort of underline what you're saying, both Spotify and Momondo have been huge inspirations to us from the very beginning. So what we're doing is essentially we are gathering all the operators into one interface, and we're seeing that our users very rarely leave our environment because they're able to place bets directly with each of the operators through our interface. So they have, you know, the complete circle from registration all the way through to bet placement and deposit and withdrawal. So we deal with all of that in one interface. And I think doing that kind of, or taking that broker approach, as you call it, I think is something that we're going to see a lot more of, especially once APIs open up. Mm-hmm. Now, due to the fact that APIs aren't readily available, we had to develop technology to deal with that. So we've done that. And I think as we progress and as we're now starting our international rollout, we're going to see a lot more competition trying to do what we've been doing now for the last year or so.
We have some audience questions. So, let's see, we're a little over, so I'm just going to kind of, wrap it up a bit. This was a great panel. We went in a different direction than I had anticipated, but we certainly followed on from the conversation that we had in our last panel, where we're sort of looking at a diminished role for affiliates in the future. And now what we're saying here is we're looking at technology and acquisition technology and retention technology being placed now back in the hands of the affiliate, and the affiliate actually taking kind of a more eminent role in the development. You even went so far as to say you're commoditizing the betting, which doesn't really matter. It's just a back-end place to go place that bet.
Just support your words. You know, technology is a complex thing. So for small teams to pick up technology is faster than for big ones. So definitely the adoption of technology by smaller teams will be faster. That's why affiliates will be on the edge. And then they will have a more bargain power to actually dictate the conditions. If you'll become a good affiliate, you start negotiating, and you know, and operators, they've been big, they don't understand the technology, it's hard, dinosaurs, you know, that's very interesting. It's totally different, you know, now going on, like, previous panel was very, like, you know, pressing on affiliates. Now it's like basically the light in the end of in tunnel.
I think it's also whoever is going to pick up the glove, because obviously there will be always like the normal affiliates, what we have today, SEO websites and so on, and that's where it ends kind of, and the one that knows SEO better is going to win because it's just sending traffic, even though there's more complexity to it, but in the bottom line of a business model or what the technology that it offers, that's pretty much it. Let's say with some banner rotation. But because licenses are available to become a broker, to store payments, so people that want to take more responsibility and already have the traffic as affiliates, that will pick up the glove. So I think we're going to see a rise of a new kind of groups of technology companies. So just like there was a rise of groups like Kindred and so on, there's going to be a rise of this middle layer between a hybrid between affiliate and operator that is rising, and then we will see another Catena Media-like company that will buy all of them, and then it will become the biggest brokerage group. But this is just how it is. So I think either the operators are going to evolve fast enough to open the gate for more affiliates to work with them, and then lower your power down, or it's not going to happen, and then technology companies like Odzium, for example, is just going to rise, and I think it will make life harder for affiliates and for operators to stay valid, because an SEO website is just not going to cut it. There's just going to be an opodo of sports betting or and so on. So
and then we also see like a very important aspect that in this industry is a consolidation will come and M&A deals will start to appear, because for operator to keep afloat, they would need to have those kind of acquisition strategies in their pocket, so they will start acquiring the such companies, and you know, to drive the traffic, to own the traffic, to own the information. Therefore, affiliates can now actually have a higher value, like on a unit of invested money, than operators, and that's amazing. You know, it's like, you know, the industry will be developing further, more M&A money will come in, more technologies to develop. So now what we see, technology is enabling affiliates to grow faster, building the value of a company. So if I would be opening one or another, I would go for affiliate side, because it's more value for a dollar invested rather than being an operator utility company in current stage. So it's cool.
Another electricity company iGaming.
This is a very interesting twist that we've taken. I love it. So we're saying, okay, for the future, let's look at a shift from affiliate to broker. And I think if you sum it all up, we talked mainly about technology here, but I think if you wanted to look at it in a broader scale, I think the message is that the affiliate needs to add value. It's no longer an SEO game where there's not any value and it's just a control game. It's not going into a new market because you know a language or you know how to advertise. It's not that you can do some tricks to get advertising in where no one else can. You actually are going to need to look and see where you actually add value to the to this entire ecosystem. And I think that's probably a very good note to leave on before we go to lunch. So ladies and gentlemen, big round of applause for a fantastic panel.